Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Freedom Highway, written by Nigel Krauth and read by Noel Hodda. Be sure to visit our website on www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda Audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. Part 1. I don't bother to stay overnight in Bangkok anymore. I go straight to Pattaya. I leave the plane and take the aircon minibus from the second-story arrivals concourse of the airport terminal. The bus sweeps down the concrete ramparts straight into the Wipar Wapi Rangsit expressway and heads for the southern highway. It's all very convenient. I hardly have to breathe the Bangkok air at all. I don't mind that swirling trip on the elevated causeway across Bangkok at night, that mad blaze of speed where six lanes of traffic negotiate four lanes marked on the roadway. I read the jagged collage of light-drenched advertising where each giant boarding, from Coca-Cola to Nestle to Nike, manages to feature a saxophone. The king plays sax, of course. And often I can watch the illuminated sheets of deluging rain, spilling the neon from the towering office blocks onto the liquid roadway where the minibus batters along. But I never forget that the overpass safety wall, momentarily washed by the bus's racing lights, obscures the lower parts of the city, the seething suburbs over which we soar, the darker sois and back streets beneath the expressway. Those remnants of an earlier time, those alleyways stained with history, are due for demolition and will be flattened. But they remain there now, for a time, below the expressway. In those narrow streets, the heads of pigs and buffalo still roll in blood, ankle deep on the market floors. I can take this much of Bangkok on arrival. Just this much. Tonight it's raining, and the city bleeds in technicolor down the juddering window beside my face, and I can see my reflection amongst the spangled tops of skyscrapers, and I recall the first time I arrived in Bangkok and was driven along this road, or at least along the road my map still shows. It was late 1957. Things were different then. I go to Thailand for the women. I say this to friends when they ask why I return each year religiously in November, in the week of the full moon. I say it, and they usually go silent. But some of my more passionate female friends have retorted, "That's exploitation, Howard. That's ugly, deplorable." I shrug and turn away. I'm content to be thought of as a bastard. Who knows what integrity another possesses? On the bus tonight, there's an excited fellow telling everyone about the No Hands Bar in Pattaya. He's a Tasmanian, and he's somewhat out of date, but I don't bother to say so. You'll be sitting there enjoying a nice ale on a stool at the bar, and guess what? Suddenly you'll feel your fly getting opened. And then, before you know what hit you, you'll feel your old fella being pulled out and stroked by some silky little hand. You look along the line of other blokes at the bar, and they're all just drinking, looking straight ahead at the bamboo panelling and sexy posters behind the bar, all with silly smiles on their faces, all looking like Santa Claus was just about to arrive. So that's what you do too. You keep it up like nothing was happening. You just keep drinking and smiling until, mate, that's when you realise what the cover charge is for. I look around and notice that everyone on the bus, apart from my companion, is male and probably Australian. They all seem interested in the Tasmanian story. I don't tell them that the No Hands Bar was closed by the authorities 2 years ago. I don't tell them that I'm Australian too. The Tasmanian looks across at me sheepishly. His gaze drops to the woman lying with her head in my lap. He thinks she's asleep already and hasn't heard his story. I think she's asleep too, but I don't say anything to him. I don't even smile. Instead, I turn to the lights of the ships on the Chao Phraya River as we slide on the elevated expressway above the Klong Toi port area. And like it always does, the winking scene below reminds me of Brasch. Of course, almost anything can remind me of Brasch. Asian women, lawyers, MG motorcars, the President of the United States, guns. Taking a Baht note out of my wallet reminds me of Brasch sometimes. But rivers running through cities always do. particularly the Chao Phraya. I'll try to tell this story in the way I believe Brasch would want it told. I'll try to leave out what Brasch didn't know, to put his viewpoint, to see the world according to Brasch. But I'm not certain about the process, about whether I'll really be telling Brasch's story, or my version of Brasch's story, or my own story. And I'm unsure whether I can tell any of it from a then point of view as opposed to a now point of view. This is how it happened. We'll get caught up, I fear, with this was how it happened. I've lived since then. I know I've changed. Does my changing change the story and change what happened? It was, of course, the 1950s. None of us knew what was going on. At least, we couldn't see it the way we do now. I believe Brasch revelled in the fact that he was part of the strongest nation on earth, the mighty United States of America, and that he wanted to help other nations. But he didn't know he was an agent of his country's need to stand in front of the world mirror and flex its muscles. I remember a series of advertisements on the backs of popular magazines then. They showed the 9-stone weakling getting sand kicked in his face at the top of the page, the bullies doing it to impress a group of giggling, swimsuit-clad girls nearby, and Charles Atlas admiring his own musculature in a mirror at the bottom of the page. The Charles Atlas bodybuilding course. I thought it was about helping poor defenceless skinny fellows to get strong. I didn't have the cynicism to suppose it might be about helping Charles Atlas get over his paranoia about the size of his dick and in the process get rich. But I did believe that Australia was the 9-stone weakling, and I was told the bully sand kickers were Russia and China. And I certainly wanted a big American muscle-bound brother, one I could look up to, one I could call on and be proud of. In the year I joined the Australian service, I didn't know what the United States had in mind for Southeast Asia, and just how calculatedly they were pursuing it. I also didn't know that Menzies had asked for nuclear weapons from Eisenhower, but instead of nuclear weapons, we got television, the Mickey Mouse Club and Disneyland and wagon train, because Charles Atlas was, after all, only looking after himself. And how could either Brasch or myself think in those days that Southeast Asia might not want us there, might not welcome us with open arms? Those girls on the sand-kicking beach in the Charles Atlas ads have for me the faces of Thai women, or at least of a particular Thai woman. I look down at Bupa's face in my lap. She's not the woman. She's just one of many substitutes. The construction work on the Bang Nha Tra Highway out of Bangkok goes on at night under arc lights, even in the rain. I can see the labourers laying steel mesh, working with wire-pulling tools, in places where the bus is halted by rain-coated flagmen and the muddy movement of trucks. After a while, the construction work is left behind, and we tunnel into darkness. And the countryside, although I cannot see it, I know to be much as it was 40 years ago, villages, coconut palms, pineapple plantations, reddish dirt. We go through occasional larger towns, lit up in the rain, and there are big factories blazing, fisheries and rubber. And off to the right I sense the gulf is rippling, and I think I see the lights of moored ships. This road is much the same as it was when Brasch was driven down it repeatedly by the security police in the last year of his association with Thailand. In that year, he was flown halfway around the world 3 times by the Thai government and had to pretend he was a Thai policeman in the hope of not being shot. He was held in the Prime Minister's holiday villa at Pattaya in fear of his life. It was because of Brasch that I left the service. Bupa stirs, and her head rolls against my thigh. I have a feeling that she's going to be all right. 1. The first glimpse Howard Moss had of politics in Thailand was through the window of the Qantas plane before it stopped with a jolt far out on the tarmac at Don Mueang Airfield. On landing, Moss had expected the bustle of baggage carts, refueling tankers, gangways on wheels, but he saw instead lines of army vehicles and rows of soldiers bristling with guns in the egg-white Asian sunlight. They were massed around the airfield terminal and out across the tarmac apron. Even before the engines of the plane were cut and the propellers began their whining deceleration, several khaki trucks approached. The alighting soldiers dropped to their knees on the steaming asphalt, lifted their guns to their shoulders, and trained them on the plane's doors, on its wheels and engines, on the passengers at their windows, on anything that was likely to move. Moss saw one soldier in the surrounding cordon pick him out at his window and set the sights of his gun squarely on him. Moss had arrived in Bangkok on the day of the bloodless coup in 1957, the 16th of September, a Sunday morning in the wet season. None of his briefings in Canberra and Sydney had prepared him for this kind of greeting. None of the grey-suited men sitting in dim offices with the central heating pipes wheezing had said to him, "The first thing that'll happen, Howard, is you'll get a gun pointed at you." The passengers on the Qantas flight waited for an hour in the plane. When they were allowed to disembark, the soldiers kept them another hour standing on the tarmac. The sun beat down on the airfield. It glanced like bayonet blades from the long, flat puddles left by the overnight rain. It glinted in slivers off the iron roof of the distant terminal building. The tropical morning air, thick with humidity, pressed around, almost a palpable substance. Moss saw that even the soldiers were sweating under their American-style combat helmets. Darker patches of khaki spotted their uniforms. He felt the nylon shirt clinging to his own moist back. The runnels of perspiration drenched his temples and flowed from his armpits. "Perhaps we will all be kept here," he thought, "until we dissolve to puddles." Moss could see no European faces except those of his fellow passengers. The rest was a tableau of uniformed ties. The Qantas plane stood silently at their backs. Another plane, even more heavily guarded by troops and dull green vehicles, stood between them and the terminal. Grey military buildings crouched in the vegetation beyond the airfield. Nothing moved. Then, as if a film director had somewhere called for action, two black limousines sped onto the airfield from a gate in the boundary fence. They bumped across the runway and headed towards the plane parked near the terminal. They drove through the cordon of troops right up to the plane's gangway. There was a blur of car doors opening and two men got out. The two men were escorted up the stairs and into the plane. There was haste and nervousness in the action, even a sense of latent brutality or convulsiveness. One of the men wore a military-style uniform, the other a business suit. They were Thai. The door of the plane was thrust shut on them and the stairs hauled away. Then the plane's four engines coughed and spat smoke and the propellers worked themselves to a frenzy. The troops moved back. The plane started forward. It taxied to the end of the runway. Swiss Air was painted on its side. It took its shuddering run and lifted into the hot sky. It disappeared beyond a fat white cloud on the horizon. Moss and the other Qantas passengers were escorted towards the terminal. They had another long wait until the terminal doors opened. When they finally got inside, Moss turned back to see that the troops still kept their positions on the tarmac, stationed and sweating in the furious sunshine. "So this is Asia," he thought. He had expected paddy fields and sampans, temples and trishaws, but Asia was instead, on first encounter it seemed, a war zone, a place of guns and khaki, of swift spurts of action punctuating a burning tedium, all without apparent meaning. It was well after midday when Moss completed his entry formalities, found his bags, and discovered the tall, sunburnt figure of Davidson standing coolly under a barrage of ceiling fans in the terminal's arrivals area. "Howard Moss?" Moss extended his clammy hand. "A bit different from the snowy mountains, eh?" Davidson said, seeing the shirt clinging to Moss's chest and his sopping singlet plainly visible through the nylon. "You always forget how hot the place gets, no matter how often you keep coming back." Moss smiled. "This is my first time in Asia," he admitted. "My first time out of Australia, in fact." Davidson laughed. "You'll get used to it, mate." He waved off a Thai porter and picked up one of Moss's bags. "You learn to live with the heat here. You learn to live with lots of things." With gangling, long strides, Davidson led the way out of the terminal building to the car parking area. Moss shuffled behind. They passed among groups of milling soldiers. "What's all the fuss about?" Moss asked.
"Oh, just another coup."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.